very important one. Comes also from, it's a contribution from Politecnico di Milano. It's also a great honor to have with us Professor Mauro Nisoli, one of the pioneers in ATO, second laser physics and laser matter interaction. He's going to give an introduction lecture in ATO, second laser physics and technologies. So thank you very much, Mauro, and it's a great honor to have you with us.
Thank you. Good morning to everyone. So I will discuss a few applications of ATO second pulses, mainly application we have done here in the last 15 years. I would like to start with the main target of ATO second science and ATO second physics. As you see here, the main target of this particular research field is the real-time observation and mainly, most important, direct control of electronic motion inside atoms, molecules, solid states, nanostructures, and so on, which are the main ingredients in order to have this application of attosecond pulses to matter. Two main prerequisites. First, you have to develop a reliable scheme for routine generation of attosecond pulses. I would like to stress this routine generation. The generation of attosecond pulses must be simple, and I can tell you it is not so simple, but for the application you need a reliable scheme in order to generate every time, every day, your attosecond pulses with correct temporal and spatial characteristics. And the second is the development of suitable experimental technique in order to take advantage of this extreme temporal resolution. And again, it is not so simple. So a short outline of my presentation. First, I will tell you why it is important, why we need attosecond pulses. Second, which are the main physical processes at the heart of generation of high order harmonics and consequently the generation of attosecond pulses. Then I will discuss just a little bit something about attosecond technology, and then I would like to show you just briefly, without entering into any detail, a few applications, mainly two applications of attosecond pulses to molecular physics. First of all, why we need attosecond pulses? A model of the atom is hydrogen atom. You have the proton, the nucleus, and then the electron, which is moving about the nucleus. This picture is not correct, okay? So which is the real picture? We have an atom in the ground state, for example, or in a particular eigenstate. The corresponding electron wave function is something like this. This part of the wave function does not depend on time, okay? And this is the part which depends on time. Ek is the eigenvalue, is the energy value of the electron in this particular eigenstate. Now, if you take the electron probability density, you see that this electron probability density does not depend on time. So it is obvious it is a stationary state. You cannot have movement in a stationary state. So which is the simple way to see from the quantum mechanical point of view to the electronic motion? You need first to create a coherent superposition of state. Okay? Only if you have a coherent superposition of states, and therefore if you create an electron wave packet, you can understand from a quantum mechanical point of view the motion of the electron inside an atom or a molecule. So for example, in the simplest case, you can obtain the simplest coherent superposition of states, just two states characterized by two different energies, E1 and E2. You calculate now the corresponding electron density, and you see here that there is a time dependence. There is an oscillation of the density of electron with time, and the corresponding oscillation period, you see here, is simply the ratio between the Planck constant and the energy difference between the states which form the coherent superposition of state. And you see here T is inversely proportional to the energy difference. Therefore, the larger delta E, the faster the motion in the superposition state. So for example, in this simple case, in the simplest case, in the hydrogen atom, let us assume to have generated in some way, it is not simple, but you can generate a coherent superposition between the 1s ground state and 2s state. Okay, it is not simple because they have the same parity, but it's not important now. You see here, this is the radial probability density for the 1s state, and the blue line is the 2s state. Now, if you look to this movie, you will see now this is the simplest way to see the electronic motion inside an atom. You see there is an oscillation of a wave packet from the 1s fundamental state towards the 2s states and back to a 1s state, okay? And the period of this oscillation is 400 attoseconds, since the energy difference between the 1s and 2s state is 10 eV. Planck constant is 4.13, let's say 4 electron volt per second. Therefore, if you make the ratio between H and delta E, you end up with 400 attoseconds. So the correct time scale for the electronic motion inside an atom or inside the molecule is the attosecond domain. This is why you need attosecond passes. And indeed, it is interesting to look to the electronic motion in this way, in the correct way, in the quantum mechanical way. Let us assume to have a simple molecule. A molecule can rotate. From the quantum mechanical point of view, this means that you are generating a coherent superposition of rotational states. The energy difference between consecutive rotational states is in the range between 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 electron volt, meaning that the corresponding period, remember H, 4 femtosecond electron volt divided by delta E, the period of the rotation is in the picosecond domain, about 40 picosecond. A molecule can vibrate. The corresponding vibrational and the difference between consecutive vibrational energy is of the order of 10 to the minus 1, 10 to the minus 2 electron volt, meaning that the corresponding vibrational period is of the order of 40 femtosecond, even less assuming the oscillation, for example, of hydrogen. It is a few tens of femtosecond. Now, so you go inside the atom, and we are taking into account the electronic motion. Now, the relevant energy are the valence electronic states, or the core electronic states. Here, as in the case of hydrogen atom, the energy difference is in the electron volt range, or tens of electron volts, and the corresponding electronic motion is in the attosecond domain. Now, if you go inside the atom, inside the nucleus, for example, here the energy difference inside the nucleus, so you have different nuclear energy, is in the kilo electron volt energy range. So if you would like to follow the evolution, the temporal evolution of nuclear motion, nuclear meaning concerning the nucleus of the atom, you need zettosecond resolution. So for the moment, already attosecond is quite difficult to achieve, so we will consider just the attosecond without going to the zettosecond domain. Now, how to generate attosecond passes? You know, the limiting pulse duration is the optical wavelength, the optical period of your radiation. For example, in the case of a short laser pulse with a central wavelength of 750 nanometers is the typical wavelength of titanium sapphire systems used for femtosecond generation. You see that the period is 2.5 femtosecond. You cannot achieve pulses which are shorter than 2.5 femtosecond using this wavelength. It is not possible to have an half optical cycle pulse, because if you calculate the Fourier transform, there is a zero frequency component, it cannot propagate. So from the physical point of view, you need at least one optical cycle. Therefore, first you have to generate XUV radiation, extreme ultraviolet radiation, because in this case you can decrease a lot as you want the optical period. For example, in the case of a pulse with a central wavelength of 30 nanometer, the corresponding optical period is 0.1, so 100 attosecond. So the first step for attosecond pulse generation is to generate XUV radiation, coherent XUV radiation, and a particular useful technique for the generation of these XUV pulses. It is the only technique used so far in a reliable way for the generation and application of attosecond pulses, is high order harmonic generation in gases in particular. This is the timeline of ultrafast optics. As you see, you can break the femtosecond barrier just using the high order harmonic generation. This is the minimum pulse duration obtained directly from the laser, the titanium sapphire laser, 5-6 femtoseconds. You can decrease down to 3 femtoseconds using external pulse compression technique, but no more than this. And now the record in pulse duration measure in I don't know if in a reliable way or not, but it is below 100 attosecond, okay? This point in 2006 is 130 attosecond. At that time was a record, and we obtained this record here in my lab in Milano. Now, from the experimental point of view, apparently the generation of high order harmonics is really simple, just apparently, because what you need is just a femtosecond laser. You focus this laser to an intensity ranging from 10 to the 13 watt per square centimeter up maximum 10 to the 15 watt per square centimeter, so it's not a lot. It is really simple to have a system like this. But you put a gas jet or a gas cell with static pressure, for example, somewhere in the focus of a laser, not exactly in the focus, but a little bit in this position, and then for a number of nonlinear effects, I will show you in a minute, you can generate the odd consecutive high order odd harmonics of a fundamental radiation. Okay? And at the output, using a spectrometer, photon spectrometer, you can measure something like this. So you have first a strong decrease in the efficiency of a generation of the harmonics corresponding to the third, the fifth, the seventh order harmonics. So you have a huge decrease in the harmonic efficiency. But then, and this is the main, was reported at the end of the 80s, very, very interesting experimental result, the efficiency in harmonic generation remain constant in the so-called plateau region, okay? And then, after a maximum photon energy, there is a strong decrease again in the efficiency of the generation of the harmonics, okay? And the maximum photon energy is related to this very simple formula, where IP is the photoionization energy, and then here is 3.2, the ponderomotive energy. I will show you in a minute what the ponderomotive energy is. Now, we can have a very simple interpretation of the physics at the heart of high order harmonic generation using this simple MEM model or three-step model. Let us assume that the electric field of our driving laser, so the visible laser we are using for harmonic generation, this is a small portion of the electric field. The intensity is 10 to the 13 watt per square centimeter, and here is the Coulomb potential seen by the outer shell electron. As you see, at the maximum of the electric field around this crest, the electric field of a laser pulse is comparable to the Coulomb potential, to the Coulomb field. So we have a strong deformation of a Coulombic barrier seen by the outer shell electron. We have a generation of this potential barrier, and this outer shell electron can tunnel out. So the first step in harmonic generation is a pure quantum effect, is tunnel ionization. The probability of tunnel ionization is really high here around this crest of the electric field. It is very high here at this other field crest of the electric field. Then at the output of the atom, the electron is free to move in the electric field of a laser pulse. After tunnel ionization, the electric field of a driving pulse is much stronger than the Coulomb potential seen by this free electron. This is why we can use the strong field approximation, because after the ionization, the electric field is really strong, and you can almost completely neglect the action of a Coulomb potential, at least for atoms. You have acceleration of the electron in the laser field, the electric field changes sign, and then if the driving field is linearly polarized, there is a very small probability that the electron, the emitted electron, can return to the parent ion. And it can return to the parent ion, it can recombine towards the ground state, and the kinetic energy gained by the electron in this movement inside the electric field is released in the form of a burst of high energy photons. Since the kinetic energy is quite high, the energy of the generated photons is quite high. It is in the XUV energy range of the photons. Okay? So you have tunnel ionization here, and then you have recombination somewhere here. Emission of one attosecond pulse. But as I said, here you can have tunnel ionization, same thing from the opposite direction in the atom, and then acceleration in the laser field, and then recombination somewhere here near to the other zero crossing of the electric field. So in a natural way, you end up with a generation of a train of attosecond pulses separated by half the optical cycle of a fundamental radiation. Okay? And the maximum photon energy is related to the ponderomotive energy, meaning the average kinetic energy of an electron which is oscillating in a laser field. And I point out that the maximum energy is linearly proportional to the intensity of a driving laser field. But you cannot increase too much this, because when you increase up to above 10 to the 15 watt per square centimeter, you ionize completely your gaseous medium and you cannot generate harmonics because you have a completely unionized medium. So you cannot play too much on the intensity. What you can do is to play with a wavelength of a driving radiation. Indeed, the maximum photon energy is related to the square of a wavelength of a fundamental radiation. So if you want to increase the cutoff photon energy, you have just to increase the wavelength of a driving field. But there is another nice physical interpretation, the real physical interpretation of harmonic generation. And it is based on this similarity. Tunnel ionization is a sort of beam splitter for the electron wave function. Indeed, after tunnel ionization, a portion of the electron wave function remains bound to the parent ion, while the other fraction moves out of the atom and then can come back to the parent ion. The interference between this electron wave packet moving in the continuum with the ground state wave function leads to the generation of an oscillating dipole, and as you know, the oscillating dipole is the origin of emission of electromagnetic radiation. So this is a very simple, very naive a movie showing this effect. So this one is just it is the square modulus of a complete electron wave function, which is the coherent superposition of a fraction of the electron remaining in the ground state plus the electron which is moving in the continuum. And this peak corresponds to the component of a wave function remaining in the parent ion, while this other, you can see more easily here where I have taken just the real part of an electron wave packet. This is the plane wave which represents in a very simple way the electronic wave function which is moving in the continuum and which can return to the parent ion. Now, I show you this movie and look at this contour plot here. You see there is an oscillation back and forth of the peak of the electronic distribution. So we generate in this way, as you see, a dipole, an oscillating dipole. And as you know, the oscillating dipole is the origin of the emission of the electromagnetic radiation. So this is the real physical interpretation of a generation of harmonics, okay? And of generation of attosecond pulses. It is this atomic antenna. The situation is more complex than this because when the electron wave packet is moving in the continuum, since it is an electronic charge with a negative charge, there is a dispersion of this wave packet which is moving in the continuum. So after propagation in the continuum, we have a broadening, a spreading of the electron wave function. And then it is the interference of this spreading electronic wave function with the ground state wave function which generate the harmonics. As I said before, if you want to increase the energy of the photons, you have to increase the wavelength of a fundamental radiation. But as always, this is it is an advantage of using a long wavelength radiation for the generation of attosecond pulses, but there is also a limit, because if you increase the optical wavelength, you increase a lot the amount of time spent by the electron in the continuum, the interval between the tunnel ionization instant and the recombination instant. You increase this time, so you increase a lot the spreading of the electron wave packet moving the continuum. Therefore, the amplitude of this electronic wave packet decrease upon increasing the wavelength. The superposition of this electronic wave packet with the continuum, with a ground state wave function, which is peak on the atom, decreases. So you decrease a lot the efficiency of the harmonic generation. So you increase the cutoff, but you decrease a lot the efficiency. Okay? So you have to find a compromise between cutoff and conversion efficiency. In any case, the conversion efficiency is small, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 at best, down to 10 to the minus 6 in the total harmonic conversion efficiency. Okay? Strictly related to the physics at the heart of attosecond pulse generation are these two important characteristics which are really important for the application of attosecond pulses. Since the attosecond pulse composed by photons is always associated to an attosecond electron pulse, which is the electron wave packet moving in the continuum, you increase the spatial resolution of your experiment, since the electron are characterized by a wavelength, the de Broglie wavelength, which depending on the energy of the recolliding electron can be down to the angstrom regime. So you can combine an extreme temporal resolution related to the attosecond duration of a photon and electron pulse with an extreme spatial resolution related to this recolliding electron wave packet. This allows you, for example, to make a tomography of molecule, as demonstrated a few years ago. And second characteristics, the attosecond photon or electron pulse are always perfectly synchronized with the electric field of a generating drive impulse. There is a perfect synchronization between the XUV radiation and the electric field of a driving pulse. This is important for the application because using a particular experimental scheme combining the XUV attosecond pulses with a portion of the IR pulses with femtosecond duration, since there is this perfect synchronization between the two, the temporal resolution is in the attosecond domain. It is not given by the cross-correlation between the attosecond and the femtosecond pulses, okay? As I told you, it is relatively simple to generate a trains of attosecond pulses, separated by half the optical cycle of a fundamental radiation or a complete optical cycle of a fundamental radiation if you break the symmetry of a problem. For example, breaking the symmetry of a driving pulse, but it is not so important. In this case, you have a centrosymmetric atom and a symmetric electric field, so you have the generation of a train of attosecond pulses separated by half the optical cycle, and then you calculate the Fourier transform, you have the odd harmonics of a fundamental radiation. But now, for a few applications, you need just one attosecond pulse. So you would like to confine the harmonic generation process to a single event, in order to have just a single attosecond pulse, or we call this single attosecond pulse an isolated attosecond pulse. How it is possible to generate an isolated attosecond pulse without going into detail, but the interpretation is really simple. This technique was proposed first by Paul Korkum and Misha Ivanov in 1994 with with an experimental apparatus which was not simple. The idea is really simple. As I said, you can generate higher order harmonics just with linearly polarized driving pulses, because only in this case the electron wave packet can come back to the parent ion. If the polarization of the driving field is circular or strongly elliptical, the electron cannot return to the parent ion. Okay? So you cannot have recombination, you cannot have the generation of XUV radiation. And then what you need in order to confine the harmonic generation process to a small, a very short temporal window, is to generate a driving pulse with an exotic polarization state, for example, like this, which is strongly is circular or strongly elliptical on the leading and trailing edges, and more or less linear just in a small portion of a driving field. What is required is that the duration of this temporal window where the polarization is close to linear must be smaller than the separation between two consecutive attosecond pulses. So it must be shorter than half optical cycle of a fundamental radiation, something around 1.3 femtoseconds. How to generate this exotic polarization state? It is actually very simple. The technique was first proposed by Henri Constant in 2003. It is based on the use of just two very simple birefringent plates. You see here you have your input laser pulse. Short duration is better. Below 7 or 6 is better. And then here you have a birefringent plate. At the output of this birefringent plate, you have the generation of two linearly polarized pulses. The first polarized along the extraordinary axis of this plate, and the other polarized along the ordinary axis. And the delay delta between these two replica is related to the thickness of this birefringent plate. Therefore, the electric field polarization of this complete optical pulse is linear here, outside the overlapping region, then again linear here, across two orthogonal direction, and here you have almost the same amplitude for the two components, and you have a circular polarized electric field. The trick here is to buy refringent plate with the correct thickness in order to have this region of circular polarization, which is shorter than half optical cycle of a fundamental radiation. This is just the opposite of what you need, but now it is very simple to have a correct polarization state because you can add a zero order quarter wave plate, so the linear polarization becomes circular and the circular polarization becomes linear. And in this way, you generate the correct polarization state. We applied this technique, and now I will show you the first application of this technique was made here in my laboratory in Politecnico in 2006 in collaboration with a group of Eric Constant. But now let me mention just briefly, without entering into detail, how you can measure the temporal characteristics of a second pulse. You need to develop a proper experimental technique. Again, from it is simple to understand, it is not so simple to have in the experiment. What you need first is to focus your attosecond pulse in a gas. So the first device is gas ionization, far from any resonance in this gaseous medium. You transform this attosecond photon pulse in an electron pulse, and this electron pulse, again, far from any resonance in this gaseous medium, is characterized exactly by the same temporal characteristics as the photon attosecond pulse. So what we want to measure now, in order to characterize the temporal duration of the attosecond pulses, what we want to measure is this electron wave packet. How to make this experiment? We simply measure the kinetic energy of these photoelectrons. We have to add a second field. It is a small portion of a fundamental radiation, and this small portion of a fundamental radiation acts as a phase modulator for the photoelectrons generated by the interaction of the attosecond pulses with the gaseous medium. And then we measure the temporal evolution of the kinetic energy of generated photoelectrons as a function of a delay between the attosecond pulse we want to measure and this femtosecond pulse. Okay? The temporal resolution is in the attosecond domain. The physics at the heart of this measurement is quite simple. You see here, this is our attosecond pulse, and this is a small portion of a fundamental radiation. I will call this streaking pulse. The reason will be clear now in a minute. This is the momentum of the photoelectrons generating this gas jet by the attosecond pulse. You see here, it is the square root of the energy, and the energy is the photon energy of the attosecond pulse minus the ionization potential of the gas used for the measurement. Then you have the generation of the photoelectrons, but here, in the same position, at the same time, we have also the action of the electric field, of a streaking electric field. Now you apply the second law of dynamics, very simple, and you see that the change of the electron momentum induced by the streaking field is simply related to the vector potential of a streaking pulse at the instant of tunnel ionization, okay? Then the final electron momentum is just the vectorial sum of the initial momentum plus the variation of the momentum induced by the streaking field. And therefore, the energy of a photoelectron at the end turns out to follow the temporal evolution of the vector potential of a streaking field. From the measurement of this kinetic energy, you have to believe me, it is possible to deduce in a unique way the temporal characteristics of the streaking pulse and also of the attosecond pulse. I just want to show you the laboratory we have here in Milano, we can say that it is a typical attosecond laboratory. It is a small scale laboratory, as you see here, okay? It is 80 meter times 80 meter, okay? Here you have the laser, is a commercial laser, 6 millijoule, 35 femtosecond, 1 kilohertz repetition rate, stable carrier envelope phase, this is the main point. Then we have a compressor stage because we 35 femtosecond for our application is too long, way too long. So we need to compress a lot this pulse duration down to 4 femtosecond using the hollow core fiber filled with noble gases. Orazio Svelto invented this technique in 1996, and we demonstrated at that time the compression of high energy pulses using this compression technique. And here is the attosecond bin line. Here you have a generation of three harmonics. And here is the spectrometer for electrons. And here is the spectrometer for the photons, okay? And this is the setup. I have no time to describe too much this. Let me show you the result. This is the evolution. Look, here on the horizontal scale is the delay, the temporal delay between the attosecond pulse and the streaking field. On the vertical scale is the energy of the photoelectrons generated by the attosecond pulse in the presence of a streaking field. And as I showed you before with formula, the kinetic energy of this photoelectron is modulated by the vector potential of a streaking field. And actually, these oscillations are the oscillation of the vector potential of a streaking field. If you take the temporal derivative, you have immediately the electric field of a streaking field. So this is the first attosecond measurement. You can measure directly the evolution of the electric field in the optical domain at the petahertz repetition rate. So it is already a very important result of attosecond technology. And believe me, using particular algorithm, it is possible to retrieve from this spectrogram in a unique way the temporal characteristic of the attosecond pulses. This particular trace corresponds to this intensity envelope of the attosecond pulses, 130 attosecond, around 30 electron volt. At this wavelength, 130 corresponds to 1.2 optical cycle of the XUV radiation. So it is an isolated pulse with almost a single optical cycle and with stable carrier envelope phase. Then let me show you briefly, really, without going into detail, a couple of applications of these attosecond pulses, in particular to molecular physics. One of the dreams of attosecond technology was the investigation of the ultra-fast electronic motion inside a biologically relevant molecule after sudden ionization, after the interaction of a biomolecule with an ionizing radiation, with a very short ionizing radiation. This is theory made by the group of Siderbaum in Heidelberg. They remove, from a theoretical point of view, they remove a single electron from a single molecular state in this particular molecule, very complex molecule, glycine, glycine, and then is a peptide, I think. You remove a single electron from a single molecular orbital. It is impossible to perform this experiment, completely impossible, because it is impossible to use an attosecond pulse, because you need a sudden, a prompt ionization, so you need an attosecond pulse. It is impossible to remove a single electron from a single molecular orbital because the spectrum, the bandwidth of the attosecond pulse is huge, 10 eV or more. And in 10 eV, you have several molecular orbital. But from the theoretical point of view, it is good to have this approximation. And you see here the result in 2 femtoseconds, already in 2 femtoseconds. So before any significant motion of a nuclei inside the molecule, you have a significant motion of the electron charge inside the molecule. In order to distinguish this process from the transfer, electronic transfer, which involved the motion of the nuclei, this ultra-fast motion of electron was called by Cederbaum charge migration. So one of the dreams of the attosecond scientists was to measure directly this charge migration process in molecules. We have done this experiment starting from the simplest molecule. It is the hydrogen molecule. And the idea of the experiment was sudden ionization, so excitation of hydrogen using a single and isolated attosecond pulse, and then to find a way to measure directly the motion of the electron which remain in the cation. Okay? The technique was the measurement of the direction of the emission of the H plus ion after the interaction with the attosecond pulse, using a particular velocity map image spectrometer, which allows you to measure directly the momenta of the photoelectrons. And the observable was the asymmetry parameter. What is the asymmetry parameter? It's this ratio. Look here, NL is the number of H plus ion emitted towards the left with respect to the polarization of the pulses, minus the number of H plus ions emitted towards the right, normalized to the total number of ions. So you can following the evolution of the asymmetry parameter, you can follow the evolution of the electron remaining in the parent ion. Why? Because if you have a H plus which is emitted towards the left, it means that the electron remain on the right. If you measure an ion emitted towards the right, the electron remaining in the mythic cation is on the left. Okay? So you can follow the motion, the localization of the electron remaining in H2 plus. And this was the result of our measurement. Don't say that it is too noisy. It is a very nice measurement, very clear. Not a joke, it was really difficult to obtain this measurement, a complete night. And we have the lucky situation that during the night, the laser remained really stable. So it is really a difficult measurement. And you see here in a color plot, blue means, for example, that means that this asymmetry parameter is negative, so you have more ions emitted towards the right, and yellow red means that the asymmetry parameter is positive, so you have more ions emitted towards the left. So here we have electron on the right, here on the left, right, left, and you see here there is an evolution of this asymmetry parameter. This is a scale of 5 femtoseconds. So depending on the electric field of the driving pulse, you have the motion of these electrons. It is not so trivial to understand from a physical point of view this physics, and I will not enter into detail, but I would like to show you something. You see, we have this quite noisy measurement. The situation is something like this. Look to these guys. All these guys are watching to this video, a 3D video, with the correct glasses. So these guys are looking to the correct scene for the movie. This woman is just looking in another direction. She sees something like this. And something like this is this measurement. You cannot understand, you need the correct glasses. If you have the correct glasses, and the correct glasses is a theoretical interpretation of the physics, you can see under this complex and noisy trace the correct physical interpretation of the physics. Okay? Just to say, and we had the We are very lucky because we collaborated at that time, and I am still collaborating with the group of Fernando Bartin at the Universidad Autónoma de Madrid. And Fernando has access to this huge computer system. I call this computer, but it is not a simple computer. As you see, it is inside the church, and is Mare Nostrum in Barcelona. And Fernando used 4 weeks this supercomputer for our simulation. The result I will not discuss is this one, and you see that theory is really in very good agreement with this result. But the main important thing is that we can reproduce the experimental result, and using this simulation it is possible to retrieve physical information. Okay, and I will conclude. Now we move later on towards a much more complex molecules, from H2 molecule to phenylalanine. It is an amino acid. An amino acid is characterized by a COOH group, the carboxyl group, the amine group, NH2, all linked together to the carbon alpha atom. And we make measurement in phenylalanine, tryptophan and tyrosine. I will show you result in phenylalanine. What we measure is the yield of particular photofragments generated by the attosecond pulse. Okay, this is the mass to charge ratio, and these are the different fragments you generate just shining the attosecond pulse on phenylalanine. And we followed the evolution of one of these ionic fragments as a function of a delay between the attosecond pulse and a small portion of the IR pulse. So we have an attosecond pump probe experiment where the attosecond pulse is the pump and the IR below 4 femtosecond is the probe. Okay? You see that we have a number of fragments with huge fragment yield. The measurement was done on this really tiny fragment at 60 mass to charge ratio, and this tiny characteristic corresponds to the ammonium dication. So it is the molecule without COOH doubly ionized. Only on these particular fragments it is possible to obtain information on the charge migration process. You see here, this is the evolution of the yield of production of this particular ion fragment. If you zoom in this temporal region, you see clearly this oscillation. And if you make this, you take the experimental measurement minus this fitting, you see clearly this oscillation with a period which is of the order of 4 and even 3 femtosecond. Again, in collaboration with Fernando Martin, we try to interpret this experimental result. It is not simple. You cannot simulate the experiment because the molecules is too complex, but they calculated all the molecular orbitals involved in the excitation induced by attosecond pulse, and you see here in 7 electron volt you have this huge number of molecular orbital, and you excite all these molecular orbital. The nice result is this one, and I will conclude with this movie. It is possible to calculate the electronic density after the interaction with the attosecond pulse. In this plot, in this movie, I will show you the yellow region means that you have more electrons than usual. And here, this corresponds to less electrons than usual. We shine the attosecond pulse, and the calculated temporal evolution is something like this. Okay? Just in 1 femtosecond, you have a huge motion of the electronic cloud in the molecule, just before any significant motion of a nuclei. So this is the charge migration process. And it is possible to see that, considering two particular molecular orbitals, you can see that there is an oscillation with the correct period. It is the period we have measured experimentally. It corresponds mainly to the motion of the electronic cloud from the amine group, this one, to the COOH group. So we have mainly after attosecond excitation, we have a complex behavior, but mainly a migration of electrons from this side of a molecule to this other side of a molecule with a period of the order of 3 femtoseconds or less. This is my conclusion. I can say that attosecond pulses are important for many applications in atomic, molecular, solid state physics. We have a number of applications, not only on molecules. Very nice application to atomic physics with a measurement, for example, of delay in photoemission. And now, more recently, very nice application of attosecond pulses to solid states. And that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions from the students first? Yes, please.
You showed this proton with electronic combination to create attosecond pulses. And which physical phenomena can create shorter pulses?
The question is, which is the main ingredient to have attosecond? The main ingredient is the tunnel ionization. Because the tunnel ionization, if you plot the ionization rate, you will see that the ionization rate has a strongly nonlinear dependence on the electric field. The ionization rate is proportional to the exponential function of minus ionization potential to 3 half divided by the electric field. So it is a strong nonlinear dependence. So you have a significant tunnel ionization in a very short temporal window across near the crest of the electric field. And this interval is about 400 attosecond. So the main origin of the attosecond pulse duration is tunnel ionization and the strongly nonlinear dependence of tunnel ionization. And then other. But the most important physics is this one.
I have two questions. First, what are the consequences of maybe placing an isotope of an atom in one of those amino acids? And second, what do you expect from, in solid state physics, for probing electron-phonon interaction or something like that in the attosecond regime?
Okay, let's start from the second one. There are already many applications in solid state physics. You mentioned the interaction of electrons with phonons. I can mention it because it is related, because it is one of the main advantage of using the attosecond pulses. It is the measurement of the transition between the temporal regime where just electrons are important and the regime where electrons and nuclei are coupled. And this is when you cannot rely on Born-Oppenheimer approximation. The coupling between electrons and nuclear degree of freedom can be followed with a correct time scale in the attosecond domain. Then for the evolution of phonons inside solids, you have also different techniques in the femtosecond regime. But in order to understand the initial coupling between electrons and nuclei, it is important to use very short pulses. For solids, with the attosecond pulses, you can also study virtual effects. You can, for example, follow the evolution of virtual charges generated by the electric field. You can drive a transition of the solids from the dielectric, from the insulating state up to the conducting state and back to the isolating states using the electric field of a streaking pulse. In this way, there is the hope to increase the repetition rate of a generation of signals inside electronic devices. The dream is the petahertz electronic, but from the theoretical point of view, it is, I cannot say simple because it is not simple, but it is simple to understand. from the practical point of view for real application to a real device is difficult. Then first question, what I expect if I change something in the molecule? I can say it is really difficult, and the correct answer should be, I don't know, because the dynamics, the electron dynamics, is really complex. And unfortunately, you cannot have hints from theory, because for the moment, the attosecond experiment, I can say they are very good benchmark for theory. You have the experimental result, and the theory can say, okay, the approximation we are using are quite good since the result of our simulation reproduce in some way the experiment. We are not in the position to say, I change something in the molecule, I calculate, and then in the experiment I would like to see this change. I don't know, okay? But the dream is really to not only to investigate the electron dynamics, the femtosecond pulses, but use the experiment in order to understand how to change the molecule in order to have a particular response from the molecule. This is particularly important in the fancy research area of photovoltaics. Here, I think that attosecond pulses, for example, can add something, because there is hope to understand the physics at the heart of the initial process in charge separation, for example, leading to photovoltaic application. And the hope is to understand how to modify the molecular structure in order to have a particular result from our measurement. This is a research field I would like to pursue in the next few years, also in my laboratory.
Any other question? So, please, the last.
Thank you very much for the nice tutorial. Thank you very much for the nice tutorial.
Thank you.
I have just one question. In the stroboscopic experiment, the stereoscopic experiment, where in the streaking experiment, where you observe this, the results for me is very clear, the left and right. Why this is not observed in only, why is observed only in the small energetic window of the electrons? As I have seen the results for energies up to 40 V or very low energies are not clear in the behavior. And what happened in higher energies in your TOF machine?
Yes, then just to make a long story short, it is because in order to have electron localization in the hydrogen molecule, you need to create a coherent superposition between a gerade and ungerade state. So, and in the case of hydrogen, the gerade state is 1s sigma g state, and the ungerade is with 2p sigma u, okay? And in order to have a coupling between the two, you need to produce photoelectrons and ion in the same kinetic energy region. So we have electrons from 5 to 10 eV, which are coming from 2p sigma u, and in the same spectral region, you have electrons coming from the 1s sigma g state. So you have ions and electrons in the same spectral region for both channels, okay? And then the situation is different if in the region where you have temporal overlapping between XUV pulses and IR pulses, and outside the coupling between the two states is simple. You just make a transition from the 1 sigma state to the 2p sigma u state or back, simply because you can absorb or emit IR photons. The situation is really tricky and very interesting in the overlapping region, because here you have a coupling between the two species, the two states, and this coupling is induced by entanglement between electrons. So you act on the electron which is emitted in the continuum, and you have an effect on the electron which remains bound in the molecule. And so here, the coupling between the two states is related to an entanglement between electrons.
Okay. Thank you. Please.
I wonder if this technique can be used to unravel the collective motion which occurs in ITC superconductors. Has it been done then?
Not yet, but there are, I think that in different groups are studying exactly this thing. It is, yes, it is one of the field of interest in attosecond physics, yes. But for solid states, we are just at the beginning, really in the infancy, because it is difficult. First experiment were done in transmission, but as you know, after a few nanometers, you absorb completely the attosecond pulses. So first measurement were done in a membrane with a thickness of maximum 50 nanometer. Now there are just an example of an attosecond experiment in reflection in germanium, not yet published. And recently, last month, we have done here a first reflectivity, transient reflectivity measurement here in the lab in a particular sample with excitonic characteristic at 50 eV, but it is not so simple.
Laser XUV experiment?
Yes.
Laser XUV.
You excite with attosecond pulse, you excite a core exciton. We measure the evolution of a core exciton using IR.
Thank you.